Namaste. The heart in me greets the heart in you. We'll begin with some opening music that I think you will enjoy, and then I'd like to talk a little bit about care, compassion, and kindness. Then my story, an introduction, my personal fable. I'd like to give some praise to doctors and some praise to nurses. A little bit of a reality check. A story you might find interesting that I call The Blue Man. Something that I think is a little bit humorous, and share with you some special moments of my experience and some what I learned from that in a conclusion. Then I'd like to open the floor up for questions and answers, and I will close with some music. So, is that okay? Okay, now, you've noticed that I started off by saying, with your kind permission. Now, that may seem a little silly to you, because I already have the permission of your professors. Professor Ducharme has very kindly invited me, and the nursing faculty have been very warm, so why am I asking your permission? Here's what I'm asking your permission for. I am asking your permission to get inside your head today. I'm asking your permission to be part of your thinking today, to be with you and for you to be with me today. And so I'm going to ask each and every one of you individually. I wish I could stand in front of you one at a time and say, do I have your permission?
You do.
I do. Do I have your permission? Okay, consider that through all of you. Because today, I am going to share something with you deeply personal. Deeply personal. This is as personal as it gets, beyond anything I've ever done before in my 35 years as an educator, in my nearly 25 years as a college professor. The piece of music is called Implications. And in those darkest hours of fear and pain, and they were fearful, and I cannot tell you how painful it is. I have whole new definitions of pain. The word agony has new meaning for me. But in those times, a song came to me. The song is written and sung by my friend. His name is Sean Phillips. He's a musician living in South Africa now. He has been a kind of rock star for almost 30, maybe even more years. And I have been a fan of his for forever. And in the past couple of years, 3 or 4 years ago, I had an opportunity to meet him. And he and I and my son also became kind of friends. Sean has a special connection to me, aside from the musical connection, because Sean had a quadruple bypass several years ago. And when I got home from the hospital, I got an email. It was the very first email he got. Hey man, welcome to the Zipper Club. This song that I'm going to share with you today is a sad song. It's a sorrowful song. It's a song about loss. And I came very close to losing everything. It is a song about a lost love. Has anybody, you don't have to raise your hand, but think, have you ever lost in that way? Boyfriends, girlfriends, I'm seeing some people going, it's painful, isn't it? It hurts a lot. There are deep emotions. There is a line from the song that goes, the pain of an ending is like a cauldron seething in fire. You know what a cauldron is? You know those pictures of witches and they're doing the big pot and it's on a big fire? The pain of an ending is like a cauldron seething in fire. But that's not the lyric that I remembered that kept coming to me. The lyric that kept coming to me was this: life, you are sacred. You are the only thing we bear. You are the adamant implication that we care. And this is about caring. Your profession is about caring. Your reason for being here and doing what you're doing is that somewhere deep in you, you care about other human beings and you care about life. So although I began by saying it's a sorrowful song, I think you will find that it ends with hope, because the last line is, I must not lose my love again.
Never brought me through these many years. She made me sound and tucked me round in every record swirling chandeliers. All the pain of an Indian is not the cauldron seething fire. No one else could ever take me away. The roses sent were never meant as offerings of peace for all the tears. Nor solace for the years alone, I cannot bring myself to voice my. Oh, but life, you are sacred. You are the only thing we bear. You are the adamant implication that we feel. Face up to what I think is real. And if she wants to go to him, I will not hold her back from what she feels. Oh, love, give me courage. It stops her pain and heals me inside. My very soul is a thing I cannot hide. The wind is in her eyes adore, the stars are never there as they appear. And gone is all the joy for me. She's found another man, and I am here. Oh, the pain of an ending is like a cauldron seething in fire. For no one else could ever take me higher in the sky to the blue of God's eye, where the winds begin to blow. And the earth is brown and green and gold with the universe above. And I must not lose my love. No, I must not lose my love again.
In my human growth and development classes, in all my classes, for a long time I have begun by saying that my goal, the goal of my teaching is that each and every one of you should live happy, healthful, meaningful lives. And that indeed is the goal. When I came out of this experience, I added something to it. I added something that I think is more important, and that is the idea of carrying into the world an ethic of care, compassion, and kindness. This is what will drive my life, and this is what will drive my teaching. Before we go any further, I want to think with you a little bit about what we mean, or what I mean, at least, by these things. Care, in my mind, is an attitude that is experienced in heightened concern for or interest in self or others. Now, a lot of people will think in terms of care, that's an attitude about me caring about you. There's got to be more than that. To begin with, we must care for ourselves. Because if we don't survive, what can we do for the rest of the world? We can't do anything if we are not strong, if we are not healthy, if we are not capable. So we must be good at not only caregiving, but caretaking and care receiving. We must take care of ourselves. But the important thing is to understand that this is an attitude. And let me tell you, folks, if you don't have that attitude right now, find another profession. You've got to care. It is the fundamental on which all caregiving professions are based. So care is the first thing that is important. Now we're going to talk about an emotion, the emotion of compassion, when you feel something genuinely. It is a profound human emotion. It is expressed in a deep understanding, awareness of, and sympathy for the distress of others. Now notice, I didn't say other people. Other living things, the planet, Mother Earth. If we feel that compassion, if we feel that emotion, it will drive us to the next and equally important thing, that is kindness. And kindness is a behavior. You can care, you can feel, but if you don't do, what's the point? It's all internal until you do something. It is a behavior motivated by compassion and other benevolent feelings, and it is manifest in humane, considerate, and sympathetic action. So those three pieces, I think, are fundamental, that you care, that you feel, and that you act on those feelings. I felt a pain in my chest. And I said to my wife, oh man, I pulled a muscle because this hurts. And I've pulled muscles before and I know it's going to take a few weeks to go away. It didn't go away. And finally I went to my doctor and we said, what's going on? And the first thing my doctor thought about, my family doctor, the first thing he thought about was, well, maybe it's heart disease. Okay, and oh no, I don't want heart disease. Think of something else. He said, no, I want you to go see a cardiologist. I went to a cardiologist and had some tests and everything looked fine and my heart was strong and he gave me a 99% all clear. You know, it's probably just muscular. Time went on, the pains got worse. Okay, I went back to my family doctor and he said, well, you know, heart disease. I said, no, we already know it's not heart disease. Well, something else could be gastroesophageal something, reflux disease. Acid reflux disease. And I said, well, this sounds better. This sounds better. So I was sent to a gastroenterologist. And he said, well, you know, sounds like heart disease to me. I said, no, it's not heart disease. We know it's not heart disease. He said, well, let's do an endoscopy. So I went in, and sure enough, I have GERD. I have acid reflux disease. Okay, that's good. We know what we have to do. We'll take the Mylanta and, you know, and the proper pills, the Prilosec or whatever, you know, and omeprazole. I'm learning a lot of drugs, you know. It's like the 60s. And so I was being treated for that for a while. And it wasn't going away. It was still coming back, and each time a little worse. I began to call it the wave. And I would get these waves of pain, and I'd just have to sit down. I'd be incapacitated. Then it would go away. So I went back to the doctor, to the enterologist, and he said, look, you got to go see your cardiologist. So I went back to the cardiologist. We did echocardiograms. We did EKGs and everything. The heart is still looking good. And so my cardiologist said, look, I want you to see a cardiopulmonologist. Okay, so I went to the cardiopulmonologist and did a breath test. Sure enough, I was breathing at 60% of capacity. Asthma. I had asthma when I was a kid. All of a sudden, it's back. I said, oh, that explains it. I have asthma. I can deal with asthma. I can deal with acid reflux disease. So we started medication for that. And long story short, or a long story not as long, I had one night where I realized that it had to be something worse. It was a night, a very unusual night, because my wife was in Connecticut visiting with my grandson, babysitting for my grandson. I was all alone with my 100-pound puppy and my three cats in the house, and I woke up at 3 o'clock in the morning with a whole new level of pain. It was just awful, awful, awful. And I went to my computer, I Googled heart attack symptoms, and there it was, everything I was feeling. And then I did something really dumb. I got in my car, I drove myself. No, I see people going, no, no, don't do that, don't do that. But I'm thinking, oh, this can't be. Who am I going to call? You know, my wife's in Connecticut. My nearest neighbors are miles away. It's, by this time, it's 5 a.m. You know, hi, what you doing? Would you mind driving me to the hospital? So I got in. I got there, and from that point on, I saw professionalism in action. I walked in. I said, I'm having chest pains. Boom. You know, come with me, okay? I was, I was in a Johnny in 2 minutes. I was laying on a table. I had a half a dozen people around me. They're hooking me up, putting nitro glycerin under my tongue, things like that. And they did the blood pressure, all of that. And I looked pretty good. It was looking pretty good. And they said, well, we want to keep it tonight for overnight. We're going to do a stress test tomorrow morning. And I did the stress test, and I came out great. You know, I'm 63 years old, and I did 13 minutes on it and couldn't get the heartbeat up enough. And he said, oh, I'll do a few more minutes. It looked like 18 minutes on the treadmill, and I'm doing good. I'm feeling very proud of myself. So everything said, all right, you're fine. You're fine. It must be something else. And then, it was a couple of weeks later. It was a Sunday night. We had a major snowstorm in Heath. You couldn't get off the mountain. It was terrible. And the wave came. And the waves were usually 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 3.5 hours that night of agony. I'm laying on the couch, clutching my chest, crying. I want to cry now. It hurts so much. It was awful. My poor wife is sitting next to me, not knowing what to do, holding my hand. I'm walking in circles. It was just terrible, and I knew, okay, something's wrong. So next morning, I called the cardiologist. He brought me right in. He set up the catheterization test and found, as I said, a 99% blockage. And one of the cardiologists, as I said earlier, had said to him, how is this man still alive? I was hours away from death, and so grateful to be in that situation there where I had people taking care of me. Now, all this time, you know, I didn't want to believe that I had heart disease. as I said in my essay, what was I thinking? Why would I not accept what both doctors and my own body was telling me? It was just that heart disease for me was too bad for my personal fable. So, little psychology lecture. For those of you who have taken my human growth and development class, you remember Piaget. And Jean Piaget, in his theory, suggests the idea of the personal fable. And the personal fable basically says this. It says, I know bad things happen. I know bad things happen to other people. I know bad things happen to people I know. But the really bad things are not going to happen to me. This is the reason that adolescents are perfectly willing to be texting while they're driving, because it's not going to happen to me. Now, there is kind of a common wisdom that as we grow, we remain being the people we were. We remain the infant, we remain the child, we remain the adolescent, and I assure you, in my wife's view, I still am an adolescent in many ways. And I think that although I know bad things can happen to me, somehow I could not accept that this was so bad, that this really horrible thing, and that's why I didn't do what I needed to do. This is why I almost lost my life, because of not being willing to accept it. If any one of you came to me and said, I have these chest pains, and I said, oh, let's go get a catheterization right away. But for me, somehow, I couldn't do that. When I was a young man, I was in awe of a lot of people. Composers, performers, teachers, professors. I was in awe. And as I grew, though, as I became more educated, as I developed as a professional, I began to shift that thinking a little bit and saying, well, I'm a performer. I am. I'm an artist. I'm an educator. And I'm not good at many things, but I'm good at this. And so that awe kind of became respect, admiration, but I began to see myself as a peer of those people that I was in awe of. After the operation, and I thought about what this man had done, he had held my heart in his hands. He had given me back the life that almost slipped away. And I can only say, my friends, once again, I am in awe. I am in awe. But then as the week went on, I began to understand that it was not just Dr. Russo I was in awe of. It was the whole profession, the whole group of doctors. And boy, I saw a ton of them. They were like there all the time, you know, waking me up out of nowhere. And they were also caring and also knowledgeable and also kind to me that I am in awe of all of them. And I must say that not just them, not just the doctors, these nurses, 24 hours a day, I would have one for 12 hours and a new one would come in, and each time one would leave, I remember the first night after the my first day, and my first nurse, I think, was Cindy. I'm not exactly sure the first one. I was drugged most of the time, legally. When she came in, about 8 o'clock, and she says, well, I'm going home now. And it was, what? What do you mean you're going home? You have to stay, you know? I mean, I know you know, we work. We work. And she said, no, you're going to love Karen. You're going to love the next person that's coming in. She's terrific. And she built up and said, oh, okay. And sure enough, it happened over and over again all week long. I didn't have the same nurse twice and the whole time I was there. And every time they were terrific. They cared for me, they were kind, they explained the things. I remember the first time I looked down. Okay, it took a while. It was like the second day. But I just kind of lifted up the sheet and went, oh my God, I've got a 9-inch scar right here. I have a distinctly disturbing urinary catheter that I have no memory of being applied. And, you know, machines all over the place. And they explained everything to me. This is what this is for, this is what that's for, this is what happened. Everything, they took all the time that I needed to understand. And I remember particularly at the end of one day, the end of the first day, it was tough. It was tough. I was scared. It was tough. And one nurse, Hilma, it was dark in the room. It was towards the end of the day, at the beginning of the night, and Hilma just came over to me. She held my hand, just like this nurse is doing. This is not me, and that's not Hilma. But she took my hand, and she said, every day gets better and better. Those words, every day gets better and better, were what I needed. And I am so grateful to the nurses and to the nursing profession and to your faculty, because you are the folks that will send these other folks out in the world. And my hope is that each of you someday might be standing over a terrified cardiac patient or somebody who is in trauma and hold their hand and say, every day gets better and better. So in total, my experience at Bay State Medical Center cardiac unit was wonderful. As a matter of fact, from time to time, I feel this little nostalgia for the intensive care unit. There was something about being totally vulnerable and totally cared for at the same time, and knowing all I have to do is just press this little button, and within seconds, you know, it's like the Lone Rangers, you know, there they are to take care of me. Sometimes I feel some nostalgia for that, you know? Not much. I'm glad not to be there. So I hope you have all deeply understood how much I admire and appreciate the nursing profession.